audio of all your favorite KCAA shows. That's right. KCAA 1050 AM is now on Instagram. Go get your account.
You're listening to KCAA Loma Linda at 106.5 FM, K293CF Moreno Valley.
Welcome to the Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. I'm your host, Briana Prince. Our show is brought to you by the i3 Social Club. The i3 Social Club is designed to bring business people and professionals together to build your business through connecting and education. For more information, go to meetup.com/i3social club, and I'll see you at our next meeting.
Hello, 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 everyone. It's happy Sunday. My name is Briana Prince. I am your radio show host for the Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. I'm so glad to be here today, and today I have a great guest by the name of Cornelius Bryant. Hi, Cornelius.
How are you doing, Briana? Thanks for having me.
Absolutely. I'm so glad that you're here. Now, I do want to go ahead and ask you the question of, you know, of course, giving people a little bit of an idea of who you are. That's the one thing that I always want to start with.
Well, my name is Cornelius. I was born in Arkansas, but I did move here when I was 3 years old. I have 7 siblings and a great parent. I have 5 children, 13 grandchildren, and I used to be a carpenter. Matter of fact, I was the first black carpenter superintendent in Riverside County. And I started carpentry in 1981, but then in 2019, once I started doing etiquette classes, I decided to retire and do this full-time because I love teaching etiquette, and also, you know, to see the improvement when people take my classes and how they improve their lives and learn skills that a lot of times we just assume people know, but if you're not taught, how do you know?
Right.
And so that's where I am today, and that's my life story, and we're here now talking, and I'm talking with you.
Yeah, absolutely. So you're an etiquette coach. Correct? Is that correct to say?
Yes. Etiquette, okay. And life skills. Because okay. Etiquette, people, they think of etiquette, they think of like dining, eating fancy foods.
Right.
But the life skills go along with, you know, all the other stuff that you need to like in life to better yourself, even to make improvements on yourself. And so that's what's important. The life skills, you learn how to communicate, how to communicate and how to talk to people. And, you know, all the things that goes through life that gives you skills, we call them soft skills. But these are sometimes just as important as what we consider hard skills, like learning business and things like that, because this helps you in life dealing with other people.
Okay, cool. Now, I want to know a little bit more about your background, though, because you mentioned you kind of breezed straight through it a bit. So how did you end up originally? You mentioned that you were a carpenter.
Right.
And when did you, so you retired from there, and then you decided to go into etiquette, correct?
Right. What happened is, I used to make banana puddings.
Ooh, that's
yeah,
good.
Yeah, and so we used to go to all these different mixers.
Okay.
And so I met this young lady one time, and she taught etiquette. Mm. And so we were like talking, we went back and forth. So one day I was at church, and this guy, he was a real big guy, but he was talking to me, and he had his head turned, and he was not looking at me or anything, and he was talking, and I couldn't hear what he was saying. So I didn't want to be rude to him. I said, hey, you know, I don't want to be rude, but, you know, when you're talking, can you look at me when you're talking? Talk a little louder so I can understand what you're saying. I go, because I did construction for so many years, you know, I'm sort of hard of hearing, and I can't hear what you're saying. Mm-hmm. And so his wife passes by. She goes, oh, well, somebody needs to teach him something. And I thought about that, you know, because at work I did this for so many years, and guys at work would always come in and talk to me and tell me their problems, and, you know, and I would teach them different things, and we would talk about different things, and I goes, wow, come to think of it, I've been teaching people for a long time. Mm-hmm. And so I called the young lady up, goes, hey, you know, I want to be an etiquette instructor, you know, what do you class you need to do, or what do you need to have to do it? She goes, well, you really don't need anything. I goes, well, so I'm thinking about doing it, but I want to teach more than etiquette. I want to teach people life skills too. And she goes, well, I'll tell you who I got my certificate from, and you can go to her class. I say, yeah, because when I tell people I'm an etiquette instructor, I want to have something to prove it, that I really know what I'm doing. And so I took this course with her. Her name is Maura Graber, and she's in Ontario, California. Mm-hmm. And so while I was taking the classes, you know, you have to do all these different things. You have to work with kids and all that stuff. I goes, but I don't want to work with kids, so I don't need to take the classes with the kids. So she goes, well, in order to get your certificate to become certified, you have to work with kids and all these different things. So it was hard for me to do all the classes because, of course, I worked. Sometimes I go to L.A. and I get home at 6, 7 at night. So when we had these certain things that we had to do in order to get certified, I would have to take off work to do them. So I take off work and go do all these different things. So I thought to myself one day, I goes, you know, I've been doing this for 38 years. You know, as much as I love doing it, but I said, but I want to do something else. And so that's when I took the training. That's when I retired. And here I am today. But I want to teach more than dining skills. I want to teach life skills. So that's why I went a little further with it than just that particular part of just learning the dining skills.
Okay. And what was it like making that transition?
It was different. Because, you know, you go from working with grown men and all that stuff all the time.
Right.
And now here you are, you're working with these kids and, you know, different race of people. Because, I mean, I even had to do classes and I taught women how to have tea parties. And so, you know, it's like, wow, you know, look at me. I used to make a joke with people, telling them, hey, look at me, a bald-haired black man from Compton teaching rich old ladies from Orange County how to have a tea party. You know, how crazy was that?
That's funny.
Yeah, that is funny. And so, yeah, then, you know, you're dealing with little kids, teaching them, and sometimes, you know, kids, their attention span is short.
Right.
And so you have to go, then you have to learn how to really talk to them and, you know, get them to do what you want them to do and, you know, teach them how to do things. It's like, you know, you're starting over again with your kids when they're small.
Right.
So it was a bit of a transition, but I loved every minute of it.
Now, do you still help kids now?
I do. Matter of fact, what I do now, not only do I help kids with that part, but I do things for the Riverside County and the San Bernardino County juvenile facilities.
Hmm.
And I'm getting ready to start right now with the Salvation Army, their rehabilitation center. So I still do things with kids and, you know, adults. And then I do other stuff, too. Like, well, I just did a class recently at Pomona Claremont McKinney College.
Okay.
So we did an etiquette class, dining etiquette class for them.
Is it an entire course or is it just like a one-day class? What does it look like?
Well, you pick what you want. Okay, because I have these different topics that I teach on. And so let's say, for example, depending on what it is that you want, you can order it. Like with them at Claremont McKinney College, all they wanted was just a dining class.
Okay.
And so that's all we did with them. We just lined them up and not lined them up. We just taught them the dining part of it.
Like how is how, that? Does that consist of how you're supposed to sit and,
right,
how, you know, eating and stuff like that?
Yeah, how you're supposed to sit, you know, your eating part and, you know, which utensils to use, you know, like if you're at a, depending on the setting, you know, because, you know, you have three or four different forks, different knives and all these different glasses, you know, which one is which. So that's the dining part of it, formal dining.
Okay.
So that's what we taught at Claremont McKinney. But let's say, for example, when I taught for in Orange County for the Young Men's League of Orange County, they said, okay, because I have different things I teach on, but they pick what they wanted because our time is short. Because, you know, the classes go on like for, you know, there's 9 classes. So that's 9 hours.
Okay.
So, you know, if you have them different times. And so they wanted a class on social skills, communication skills, and dining skills. So then we've tailored programs to fit people's needs or what it is they want. And so that's what we did with them. So each person is different. So we alter our program in order to accommodate what it is they want.
Okay.
Like, for example, when we do the classes at these facilities that's upcoming, we're going to do all 9 classes.
All night classes or
9?
Oh,
there's
all
9
night.
Total.
Oh, okay, gotcha.
Right.
So it's like a whole 9 course class, right?
9 course class.
Okay, nice. And so with those classes that you do, how often do you have them?
Well, we're going to be having these once a week.
So every week they're going to be different?
Every week they're going to be different.
And is this at a physical location or is it online?
No, physical location.
Okay, where's that going to be at?
See, these are going to be in San Bernardino at the Salvation Army on right up the street. So, you know, these are the in-person facilities. Then, of course, with the juvenile facilities there, you're doing them inside those facilities. But it's wherever people want. I mean, it's better for me to do classes in person because a lot of time if you're doing it online or something like that, you know, people turn the cameras off.
Right.
And they're not responding or who knows what they're doing. But if you're in person, you can make a better connection. And I found that when you do stuff in person, the connection you make with people, the relationship you build, that's what makes a difference. Because a lot of time you get in these places and the people are there, well, you know, especially let's say I did a class in San Bernardino, and it was mostly foster kids in the class. You know, they were having problems and issues. So you need to be in person with them to make a connection with what they're used to. They're used to being a number. And so what right. they're used to, they just used to people like have them there for whatever to make money off of them.
Mm-hmm.
But in order to make a real connection, you have to get in person. They have to know that you care for them.
Right.
And see that you care because they can tell, you know, you'd be surprised. They can tell right off the bat if you really care about them or if you're just in it for the money. And that's what kind of response you get when you're trying to talk to them and teach them things. You know, they respond to the way you treat them and the way they feel about you. Because sometimes you walk in there and, you know, these kids are angry or these right. people are angry.
Mm-hmm.
And so you're thinking, oh, well, I'm just going to go in here. And then if you don't have control of yourself or self-discipline, what can happen is then you'll get out of control. Because like I said, a lot of them, they're angry, they're cussing and all this stuff. And if you don't know how to control yourself, now you're angry and you're cussing back. And that's what they used to. Because a lot of time that's what they do because that's the only response they know.
Right.
So if you turn around and you're angry and you're cussing back at them, you're just what they're used to. You're just the same thing they've always gotten.
Now, what group of people do you generally help? Is there a group of people that you specifically help?
No, I help all people. But, you know, it would seem like just from what I have upcoming, people say, oh, well, these are people who are hard to get along with or people who have issues. But a lot of time what I tell people, we all have some type of issue.
Mm-hmm.
It's just we learn to manage them differently. So that's why it's important that when you learn these things, that you're able to better manage your situation. And that's what it's all about. How do you manage your situation? How do you manage your anger? You know, how do you communicate with somebody that something hurts you without becoming violent? And that's what's critical. That's what the communication part is. That's why out of all the things I teach, communication is first and foremost, I believe, the importance. Because everything else will fall under that if you can communicate these different things to them. You know, it's easier to have them have somebody accountable to something if they know you're not trying to downgrade them or something like that. So if you're telling people to be accountable, it's all about how do you communicate that to them in a way that they understand it and they're not taking it as you're trying to downgrade them. Or, you know, a lot of times people, what you learn, like if we discipline somebody, you know, if you grew up in a house where all they do is cuss at you, so, you know, what do?
Right.
You turn around and do the same thing. Or if you grew up in a house of violence where you were abusive, you know, that's what you do because that's all you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so, but then we won't think that people should know better, they should know this, but they don't. Things are taught and things are learned.
Oh, absolutely. You know, that's one thing that I've learned a lot is how important your upbringing is and to who you become, just because so much of what we learn from, you know, the critical periods of, you know, newborn to 7 years old is the most important years of a child's life during those developmental period. And so, yeah, I know exactly what you're talking about. Now, with the etiquette, how would someone know that they actually need to have that kind of training?
How would they know? That's a good question, because you can just see, like, when you go out other places, the way other people act.
Okay.
You know, and that'll give you a clue if you need some training, be it for the way you talk, you know, the way you look or anything like that. You know, and then a lot of times, if you're in an environment and you're the only one cussing and you're the only one angry, maybe that's a clue. Oh, maybe I need some help.
Mm.
Or maybe I need some training. And a lot of times people just want to better themselves.
Right.
So when they go to different places, because now you feel uncomfortable, you don't feel secure in where you are and what you're doing. You go, oh, well, maybe if I get this training or I do this, then I feel more secure, more comfortable in my surrounding. Like if you go to school, you know, you grew up in a household where, you know, you ate with one fork,
mm-hmm.
everything you ate, then you go other places that your job takes you or you become in some sort of business And now you go places and there's all these forks and spoons and glasses. You think, well, okay, well, maybe I need to go someplace to find out how to use them and what each one is for. Mm-hmm. So it just sort of clues you when certain situations come up. If you don't feel comfortable, then you need to maybe reach out and get some help or get some training.
Right. Okay, cool. Now, we do have to go on a quick break, so we will be right back with you guys in just a little moment.
Openings for one-hour talk shows. If you want to host a radio show, now is the time. Make KCAA your flagship station. Our rates are affordable and our services are second to none. We broadcast to a population of 5 million people. Plus, we stream and podcast on all major online audio and video systems. If you've been thinking about broadcasting a weekly radio program on real radio plus the internet, contact our CEO at 281-599-9800. 281-599-9800. You can Skype your show from your home to our Redlands, California studio where our live producers and engineers are ready to work with you personally. A radio program on KCAA is the perfect work from home avocation in these stressful times. Just type kcaaradio.com into your browser to learn more about hosting a show on the best station in the nation or call our CEO for details. 281-599-9800.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, how you doing? My name is Thomas F. Chappelle, Jr., and I am one of the hosts of the Real Men of Real Estate radio show here on KCAA Radio. I'm here to inform you about one of my new books that are getting ready to come out on Indiegogo regarding the 50 Educators of Real Estate. I wanted you to travel with me on this journey on this real estate space thing. A lot of people are very interested in real estate because of the programs they see on television. And a lot of people say, hey, want to be able to change my career, or, you know, I can make a lot of money doing real estate. And these gentlemen are very well spoken on their ventures in real estate. So come with me and take a look at what we're talking about in this book to be able to help you with your dreams and your challenges and whatnot. The book will be on Indiegogo. You can get an early copy, or you can wait till the holidays and give it to that special someone. So once again, this is Thomas F. Chappelle, Jr., and I approve this message.
Welcome back to the Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. My name is Briana Prince, and I'm here with Cornelius, an etiquette coach. Now, Cornelius, obviously, we were talking a lot about your business and getting to know you a little bit better. But now I want to kind of transition a little bit into entrepreneurship. Because earlier you mentioned that you were a carpenter, which you did for a while. And with being an etiquette coach, you said that you started in 2019, correct?
2019.
Okay. So how has that been, as, you know, going from that original mindset of having your carpenter business to transitioning to the etiquette business?
It's different, like I said before, because when you're the carpenter, you're going to work and you have a specific duty and you do that. And every week, you know, you have the check coming in,
right?
And it's consistency. Has been the entrepreneur, now it's up to you to go out and generate the business.
Absolutely.
And now in generating the business, you're spending money going out there to these different seminars and these different places. So you're spending money. And so if you're not having money come in, you know, that becomes unbalanced. So now you're spending more than you're making sometime. And then you start wondering, wow, did I make the right decision by doing this?
Right.
But then in the long run, he goes, you know what? This is something that I pursue because I love it.
Yeah,
you know,
absolutely.
And I love the possibilities that can happen, the prospect of helping people. So that's the main difference right there.
Now, that transition for you, was it a hard transition for you, given the fact that you didn't have that consistent or income coming in?
It wasn't so hard because I sort of prepared for it.
Oh, you did? Okay.
But normally, if you're just becoming an entrepreneur, you know, you're starting off usually in the business and you don't have any background or any finances coming in. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that can be a bit of a stretch.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, because now it's like, okay, well, you know, a month's passed by and there's been no checks coming in. There's been no money coming in. Uh-oh, what's going on? Things are dwindling.
Yeah, the unpredictability when starting off as an entrepreneur is definitely difficult. And obviously it depends too, because it depends on the support you have at either, you know, both at home and within the business that you're going into as well. It definitely makes a difference. So something that I have mentioned previously and, you know, in one of my previous shows is just the fact that, you know, as an entrepreneur, like you have to really be disciplined, really, because at the end of the day, you know, you don't have that steady paycheck coming in. You really have to rely on yourself, but also having support is very huge too, to make sure that, you know, you're doing what you need to do.
Right. That's true. But not only financial support,
oh,
but
yeah,
you have to have moral support, because when things happen, you know, you have to have somebody to go and talk to. And, you know, it's important to have somebody say, oh, well, you know, don't give up. You can do it. As opposed to a lot of times you get people that be like, oh, I told you you shouldn't have did it.
Yeah,
I told you shouldn't have did it.
That's support in every possible sense. You know, I had a lady, Atlantis, that was on the show a couple weeks, actually probably closer to a month ago. And she was just talking about how, you know, working with family members can be very difficult, you know, and that's something that, you know, I've heard a lot of people say over the years and stuff like that, you know, working with family is very difficult. And then family in general can, they have your best interests in heart, but they can kind of dissuade you from entrepreneurship because of the uncertainty of it. So it is one of those things where I feel like you have to, you know yourself, number one, and be confident in yourself and your ability to achieve what it is that you're wanting to do. So that way you actually do see the success that you're wanting to see. Now, is there, as an entrepreneur, is there something specific that you maybe do on a daily basis, on a regular basis, or something like that, that you probably didn't do before when you were a carpenter?
Well, what I do now is that you get up every morning, you're reading these emails. Mm. You're reading these emails and you're going to all these different events and, you know, and these seminars, and then you're talking to people and you're meeting people. And, you know, now that I started doing this now as a carpenter, of course, I was a superintendent, so I was used to being around people and, you know, with, let's say, higher education. Mm-hmm. But now I find myself, I'm talking to judges and attorneys and people like this, and, you know, all these different, you're like, wow, you know, I never thought I'd be here. You know, mm-hmm. then when people come, you know, mayors and city council people,
right.
It's like, you know, this is a big change for me, because especially because I worked outside all the time. Mm-hmm. So now everything's inside,
right.
And all these different things. You walk in these places and I goes, wow, this is pretty cool to come in here and, you know, to walk in a courtroom to talk to a district attorney and stuff. And I'm not up for a case, you know. So, I mean, not that I was up for a case before, but the whole thing is just different.
Right.
And that's what I do. And like I say, reading emails and talking to people. And a lot of times you're sitting on the phone all day talking to people and you're waiting on this call, that call, then you're on this email, that email. And, you know, just the level is different as opposed to when you actually working with the people and you're going out there, you're working with them all the time. And lots of things, you know, these are conference calls, and so the structure is different.
So is there a specific mindset that you have to make sure that you stay within in order for you to continue doing what you're doing as an entrepreneur?
Yes, you have to have the mindset, because it's easy when things aren't going your way. You know, mm-hmm. you have to be flexible, because a lot of times things are supposed to go one way and this is supposed to happen. Then you'll get a call or email a couple of days before, oh, we have to cancel, we have to reschedule. And you have to be like, wow, you know, you got to keep going. You got to just have that drive and that passion for what you're doing, because sometimes it may be weeks and nobody calls you, or months and you don't have anything going and you're constantly working and building these things up. And he goes, well, you know, we're going to do this on this day, or we're going to do this. Then that day gets closer and they cancel out on you. Or even sometime you'll go places and people are supposed to be there and you get there. You're like, okay, where are they at?
So what do you tell yourself in those types of situations?
Just keep pushing. Mm. Just keep going. You know, it's going to get better. And, you know, the reward when it happens is going to be great.
Yeah.
But, you know, at the same time, sometimes you're angry. Hey, you know, you couldn't call me and tell me you weren't coming. You know, I drove all the way from here to L.A. And then when I get there, you say, oh, some came up, I can't make it. you're driving back. So, you know, it's a bit of anger mixed in, but, you know, in the long run, you know, it's what you do. And you say, oh, man, this is what I was built to do.
You know, that's something that I try to make sure that I remember constantly, is just the fact that at the end of the day, things happen that isn't in our control, but which, you know, we have no control over. But the things that we do have control over, which is our response to those situations, we have 100% control over. So, and that's something that I thought about, because years ago, I went to a life insurance conference, and this gentleman was talking about how he was in a home, and he gets a phone call saying that his brother had passed away in the middle of a meeting with a client. He pushed through that meeting. He didn't just dip out or anything like that. He pushed through, handled what he needed to handle. And he said that his thought was that I can't change what has happened, but this is a family that needs help. Let me continue doing what I'm here for and help this family, and I'll handle my stuff afterwards. And it was just the mindset difference. I'm like, wow, that's amazing. And so that's where I've kind of thought about for myself, like, wow, that's so true. Because he made that point of life happens. You know, we have no, because he was talking about like 45 minutes before that meeting that he was in, he actually had just spoke with his brother, just spoke with him. But, you know, he ended up in a car accident. But anyway, you know, so when people have, when I listen to people who are very successful and I hear them say things like, you know, we have no control over some things that happen in life, but we absolutely have control over how we respond to situations. It's like, wow, you know, that's so true. So mindset, I think, is extremely important, and it's just a matter of what you tell yourself every day with situations. And don't get me wrong, that's something I'm still working on, and I always will be.
Always a work in progress.
Yeah, absolutely. But I also want to, one thing that I always try to make sure that I do is I'm always learning and progressing. So when in situations, you know, I always have to, you know, check my mind. And there was another gentleman that I had on the show, Malcolm Lilienthal. He was actually really, really great too. I've had a lot of great guests on this show. But one thing that he was talking about is mindfulness, you know, having mindfulness and making sure that you're understanding where your anger is coming from when you're angry, you know, making sure that you're present and you understand and know where you are. You know what I mean?
Right.
So yeah, anyway, with entrepreneurship, I think that there is a huge level of mindset that you have to make sure that you're focusing on pretty much daily, actually, just because, like, I think it's so easy to get bogged down by what's going on in the news or in your local cities. I mean, someone was just telling me earlier today that there was a fire. I forgot where it was, but the Taco Bell in Moreno Valley ended up on fire. And it's like, wow, that's so crazy. I don't know if anyone, you know, died or anything like that, but it's just crazy, you know. And so mindset, man, it's important.
That is, and you have to stay disciplined. Because a lot of time when, you know, you're on the computer and you have these pop-ups.
Mm-hmm.
So you're on the computer, stuff pops up, and then,
yeah,
you know, oh, yeah. I'm going to check this out, I'm going to check that out. Right. And you keep going, and something else pops up. Next thing you know, you look up and it's, oh, man, the day is gone. All you've done is wasted time looking at pop-ups and different things. So discipline is a great part of the mindset. Like you say, mindfulness, too. And it just, you know, to be disciplined and not allow yourself to get distracted or just focused. Especially when things aren't going good, it's easy to say, oh, you know, then you start questioning yourself, wow, did I do the right thing? Did I make a mistake?
Right.
And it can go on and on. And if you let your mind run crazy, you'll be all out in left field.
Well, honestly, I appreciate that you even brought up the idea of discipline, because, you know, I agree with you. You know, when I was in college, I actually studied psychology.
Wow.
I don't know how I ended up. Well, you know, realistically, I never wanted to go into psychology. I just didn't know what I wanted. You know, it's that whole preschool to 12th grade thing. And then all of a sudden you're asked, what do you want to do? I don't know. I've never been exposed to anything. How am I supposed to know? So I just said psychology. But anyway, one of the classes that I took, you know, we ended up taking personality tests, and I surprisingly was strong with discipline, whereas all my other friends were low in discipline. And it's so funny because the teacher ended up mentioning that that's one of the hardest things for people is discipline. So there, like, even in my life, there's little things that I do intentionally to be disciplined. So for example, I wake up at 4:30. Do I like getting up at 4:30? To be honest, I do not, but I do it for discipline, you know, just to discipline myself. every single day. You know, it's rough. It's easy, but I give myself no choice.
Right. Even like me, what I do is when I get up in the morning, you know, this is my routine. Mm-hmm. I'll get up in the morning, I'll pray, and I'll read my scriptures before I do anything. Because if I don't, once you start doing life and all that, then that, you know, it's the day is gone and you've forgotten all about it. Or, you know, that helps put me in the right mindset, too. Because, you know, when things happen, you have to be able to go, okay, you know, this is what happened. This is what I need to do. And through that and self-discipline, then you're able to handle the situations better.
Yeah.
I mean, sometimes it don't have to be bad. Something can go so good. And now you're just, oh, wow, you know, I'm so excited about this thing that went happened good. So now, oh, I'll just do the work tomorrow.
Right.
You know, I'm going out now to enjoy the day.
You know, even as entrepreneurs, I feel like we have to give ourselves a little bit of credit, too, and acknowledge the little things that little wins that we get in life, too, because I think it's easy for us to kind of get lost in our big goals. And rather than saying, oh, my gosh, today I made X amount of dollars, or today I achieved this goal, or whatever, and stuff like that. We do have to actually go on another break, so we will be right back with you guys in just a moment.
Openings for one-hour talk shows. If you want to host a radio show, now is the time. Make KCAA your flagship station. Our rates are affordable and our services are second to none. We broadcast to a population of 5 million people. Plus, we stream and podcast on all major online audio and video systems. If you've been thinking about broadcasting a weekly radio program on real radio plus the internet, contact our CEO at 281-599-9800. 281-599-9800. You can Skype your show from your home to our Redlands, California studio, where our live producers and engineers are ready to work with you personally. A radio program on KCAA is the perfect work from home avocation in these stressful times. Just type kcaaradio.com into your browser to learn more about hosting a show on the best station in the nation, or call our CEO for details. 281-599-9800.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, how you doing? My name is Thomas F. Chappelle, Jr., and I am one of the hosts of the Real Men of Real Estate radio show here on KCAA Radio. I'm here to inform you about one of my new books that are getting ready to come out on Indiegogo regarding the 50 Educators of Real Estate. Wanted you to travel with me on this journey on this real estate space thing. A lot of people are very interested in real estate because of the programs they see on television. And a lot of people say, hey, want to be able to change my career, or, you know, I can make a lot of money doing real estate. And these gentlemen are very well spoken on their ventures in real estate. So come with me and take a look at what we're talking about in this book to be able to help you with your dreams and your challenges and whatnot. The book will be on Indiegogo. You can get an early copy, or you can wait till the holidays and give it to that special someone. So once again, this is Thomas F. Chappelle, Jr., and I approve this message.
Welcome back to The Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. My name is Briana Prince, and we've been speaking with Cornelius Bryant, the etiquette coach of The Renaissance Man. So I know we've talked about a couple different things, but I kind of want to get a little bit more, because the type of people that are listening are people who are aspiring entrepreneurs or current entrepreneurs, and I always like to try to get some advice that you would give to someone who is aspiring to be an entrepreneur.
Just make sure whatever you want to do that you enjoy doing it, because you have to realize not only you're going to do this for a career to make money, but you're going to spend a lot of your time and effort and sweat doing it. So you want to make sure it's something that you enjoy doing. Mm-hmm. And then you have to realize that you're not going to be successful overnight. Well, maybe some do. It's going to take time. So you got to take time and do it. And don't be hard on yourself if you know make mistakes. Let's say, for example, if you start off doing it one way, you got to be flexible and say, okay, if this way is not working, you know, change the way you're doing things or change who you're doing it from. And I think it's important, too, depending on what you're doing, to serve almost like an apprenticeship doing it. You know, find somebody who's in the business you're in and learn from them, you know, learn from their mistakes, you know, ask questions and don't go into it you know, when they're trying to help you out, thinking you know it all.
Right.
Oh, no, no, this is the way you do that. You know, I've been doing this for 20 years. You've been doing it for 2.5 hours. And you're telling me everything I'm doing is wrong. You know, be willing to listen and willing to learn.
I like that you brought that up because, you know, I feel like a lot of times we can get so used to doing things the way we've always done it and thinking that that's the proper way and the right way to do things. And I've seen this with different businesses in general because they're so stuck on what they've done, been doing for the past 20, 30 years. But then what's always changing is number one, technology. Technology is always changing. So we have to adapt to technology and adapt to everything. So at least I can't remember who it was, but I like to listen to a lot of audio and, you know, there's different people that I follow, like Les Brown, Tony Robbins. I mean, there's Lisa Nichols. I mean, there's a whole list of people that I like to follow and listen to. And I can't remember who it was, but someone had mentioned how, you know, when someone is when in business, you have to make sure that you're constantly, you know, learning because things are constantly changing. So when things are constantly changing, you have to be able to adapt to that change. Otherwise, you kind of get left behind. You know, I don't know if you've read the book, Who Moved My Cheese? Like that.
No,
that's
no, that's on the
oh,
list.
Oh, no.
Right.
Oh, okay. So that's a great book, too, that, you know, pretty much clearly, I think, lays that out where, you know, these guys are doing, or these mice, I think, are doing the same thing every single day, but then their cheese is gone and they're left without any cheese and they're wondering where did the cheese go? Whereas I forgot who they are, man. It's been a minute since I read it. But the other characters ended up, you know, going off. They saw that the cheese was diminishing, and so they went to go find new cheese. And so they ended up, long story short, ended up finding their cheese, whereas the other guys are still trying to figure out where their cheese went, you know? And so I think that's actually a great representation of, you know, entrepreneurship and how you have to, well, I mean, think that's business in general. You have to make sure that you're adapting to different things that are happening within your business or whatever when things change.
Right, that's why you have to keep educating yourself.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, that's why I go to all these seminars and different things because, you know, when the cheese moves, you got to move with the cheese.
Mm-hmm.
So in this case, the cheese is somewhat the money or the clientele. So you have to be able to move with it.
Right.
Even like now with all the technology, like you said, because before I used to write all my stuff down with pencil and paper.
Yeah.
And people were like, hey,
<Still do. laughs>
hey. Well, people were like, hey, why don't you use this? I want to use this. I go, no, this is good. This is good.
Mm-hmm.
But now that I've learned how to do Word docs and all that stuff, now I do all the stuff with that and I can correct it. Or if I send something to someone and they don't like the way it looks or whatever, then they can change it and send it back to me as opposed to you're doing the writing and all this. And so, you know, like I say, technology, you have to adapt to it. Especially now, because most of the people who you deal with, they're tech savvy. And these kids, they're 2 years old and they're showing you how to do stuff.
Oh my gosh, I know.
So yeah, so you really have to be able to adapt to it.
Yeah.
And you know, to go where it sends you and not be afraid.
Yeah.
That's the thing. A lot of people, they're afraid to change, to do things.
You know, I hear that a lot, that we as human beings are afraid of change. And I actually don't know where that comes from. It may be fear, I don't know. But change is kind of a part of life when you think about it. Cause like, think about it. I'm 30 years old. I'm not in the same body I was when I was a year old. You know what I mean? Like, so whether I want to, so whether I like it or not, we're always changing, you know, I'm not a little kid anymore. You know, I'm not in high school anymore or anything like that. So I think naturally change is a part of life. And I think it's funny when I hear people say that they're afraid of change because, you know, some people like actually mention that and that they are afraid.
Yeah, because you're used to stuff being here, you know, you're just used to doing it this way, everything being done this way, no matter what it is, now, because your mind is focused. You can do it in your sleep.
Mm-hmm.
But now when change comes, oh, wow, you know, no, that's not the way we do it. We do it like this. And so now you're fighting against change, and that's just causing stress on you.
Mm-hmm.
But it's inevitable.
Yeah, it really is.
It's like, you know, you just got to learn how to deal with it, and that's part of the mindset.
Yeah.
That's where we go back to the mindset. That's part of the mindset,
mm-hmm.
dealing with change and making it to work for you the best way possible.
Yeah. And life is so unpredictable too. My goodness. You know, like, I feel like we can, I think we all pretty much plan for the future to a certain extent and everything, but then, you know, life happens and something kind of alters your entire thinking on what you were intended to do or what you wanted to do in the first place and stuff like that. So yeah, it's interesting. It's really interesting.
Right. Yeah. So you just got to, some people say flow with it, but you know, you need to flow in a way that you kind of stay in control of it.
Mm-hmm.
Because like we talk about the mindset and all these things,
right?
You know, what happens to you and your reaction to what happens.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's awesome. Well, okay. So now aside from, because is there something that you wish that you would have known when you were younger? Like, let's say when you were starting out, because when did you start in carpentry?
When I was 20.
Okay, you were 20. So what would you have told your 20-year-old self, knowing what you know now? If you could go back in time, what would you tell yourself? Anything different?
Work smarter.
Work smart.
work smarter. Because, you know, a lot of times the thing we don't realize is that certain things we do when we're younger,
mm-hmm.
when you're young, you're not thinking about 20, 30 years down the line.
Right.
But things you do when you're young,
mm-hmm.
it affects you when you're older or affects you down the line. So decisions you make and things you do and choices you make,
mm-hmm.
you know, even though you may have done it at whatever age, 15, 16, 20,
mm-hmm.
but here you are, now you're 40, 50, and now those decisions come back and they affect you sometime in a good way and sometime in a bad way.
Right.
But when you're young, you don't think about the future and think that so much as, you know, what I'm doing this, or I'm doing that, how it can affect me.
Mm-hmm.
You know, what effect it'll have on not only me, but, you know, my family and everything else. And so it just, I would have took more time to really think things out and be smarter about what I was doing and plan more,
okay.
you know, from a positive standpoint.
So what exactly would you do, would you have done differently had you known?
Had I known what I knew, I think I would have stayed in school longer and just,
really?
Just you're right. Yeah, just stayed in school longer and, you know, and took my time with things because, you know, I rushed to grow up.
Mm.
You know, I was like, oh, you know, I'm 18, I'm grown, and, you know, I move out the house and I do all this stuff, you know, because I'm grown.
Right.
You know, and then, you know, when you're young and you're doing stuff, so because sometimes you can get on a path
mm-hmm.
and you're just constantly running. You know, so even now, like sometime, you know, I'm doing stuff, I'll be like, oh, you know, I'm sitting down, I'm not doing nothing. I should be doing something. I'm sitting here wasting time,
mm-hmm.
you know, and you know, you have to learn how to relax. And so I would have just took more time to learn how to relax more and, like I say, make better decisions and, you know.
You know, that's a question that I like as far as, because something that I wish I would have done earlier is invested, just because, like, I'm in a stage, you know, you and I had talked about this a little
right.
bit, where I'm in a stage where I really want to build up passive income. And I wish I would have thought about that a long time ago, to be honest,
of
because
course,
obviously
yes.
the more time you have, the better. So if I would have done that when I was 20, I'd be in a much better situation.
Right.
I mean, it, you know, it's so funny how there's so many different things to know about out there, a lot of information out there. And yeah, you know, just things that we kind of need to know but aren't taught in schools, you know, especially, you know, the whole preschool through 12th grade, because, like, you know, it's just little things, like, for example, financial education, that's not taught in schools or in public education anyway. You know, even investing, that's not something that's taught or even really thought about, I guess, much. But it is something that I wish I would have delved into a little bit more. Now, also with entrepreneurs, so if you had to go back to when you were 20, would you be an entrepreneur? Is that something that you would have considered at that time?
You know, actually, when we were younger, we used to have me and my brother, we had a home repair service.
Oh, did you?
Yeah, so we would do home repairs for people, you know, like a handyman service.
Oh, nice.
But I was still doing the carpenter work. So I think that by doing carpenter work, it really helped me out because not only did it teach me discipline and how to work with other people and how to manage people and do that, you know, and then now that I am the entrepreneur, those skills that I'm using now. But had I started off as an entrepreneur, I don't think so, you know, because of all the work and all the effort you have to do. And, you know, you're not always getting paid.
You know, it is harder.
It's a lot of time.
Yeah, it is definitely harder.
And so I think the path I took is good. But, you know, some people, when they're younger, they already have their head on straight. They know what they want to do.
Right.
Because, you know, over the course of time, you'll start off doing one thing, and then you do that 5 years, you'll do something else. A few years later, you're doing something else. But if you're going to be an entrepreneur, you can start off doing that. But as you change everything, you have to upgrade. In other words, you have to do better than you were doing before. You can't just go from one thing. Next thing you know, the next month you're doing something else. So you're going from a possibility of making $100,000 to you quit, you give up on that. Now you're making no thousands, you know. And, and it's a thing that you, it takes time. It takes time. You have to be able to settle in and don't give up and be so hard on yourself to realize that, you know, it's going to take time to build this business. It's going to take time to do all these things.
Right.
And, you know, a lot of times, depending on you, who you are, you're not going to invest that time because, you know, you just go from one thing to the next, one thing to the next.
Right.
So to be a great entrepreneur, young people, if you want to do it, you know, you got to be consistent.
Consistency.
You got to be consistent.
That's like the most common thing that I've heard as far as, you know, if you want to go into entrepreneurship is consistency. So definitely understand that.
Right.
All right. We're going to have to go on a quick break. So we will be right back with you guys and wrap up in just a little bit.
Talk shows. If you want to host a radio show, now is the time. Make KCAA your flagship station. Our rates are affordable and our services are second to none. We broadcast to a population of 5 million people. Plus, we stream and podcast on all major online audio and video systems. If you've been thinking about broadcasting a weekly radio program on real radio plus the internet, contact our CEO at 281-599-9800. 281-599-9800. You can Skype your show from your home to our Redlands, California studio where our live producers and engineers are ready to work with you personally. A radio program on KCAA is the perfect work-from-home avocation in these stressful times. Just type kcaaradio.com into your browser to learn more about hosting a show on the best station in the nation or call our CEO for details, 281-599-9800.
Hey, ladies and gentlemen, how you doing? My name is Thomas F. Chappelle, Jr., and I am one of the hosts of the Real Men of Real Estate radio show here on KCAA Radio. I'm here to inform you about one of my new books that are getting ready to come out on Indiegogo regarding the 50 Educators of Real Estate. Wanted you to travel with me on this journey on this real estate space thing. A lot of people are very interested in real estate because of the programs they see on television. And a lot of people say, hey, want to be able to change my career or, you know, I can make a lot of money doing real estate. And these gentlemen are very well spoken on their ventures in real estate. So come with me and take a look at what we're talking about in this book to be able to help you with your dreams and your challenges and whatnot. The book will be on Indiegogo. You can get an early copy or you can wait till the holidays and give it to that special someone. So once again, this is Thomas F. Chappelle, Jr., and I approve this message.
Welcome back to the Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship. My name is Brianna, and I've been speaking with Cornelius Bryant, and we are going to be wrapping up here in just a little bit. But Cornelius, one question that I always like to ask people that I bring on the show is, what's the legacy that you want to leave behind to the world?
To the world? Well, I want to help people. I want to help people to the point where if I help you, it gets passed down to generations to change your life, to make your life better, to change the family's dynamics. You know, with some families, like say, anger is passed down and all these things are passed down.
Yeah.
But if I can help you to change the way you look at yourself and the way you teach your kids teach their kids, you know, to change the whole generational dynamics. And that's what I want to do, make it a better place, make people better for themselves and their families, and you know, just a better place to live, and people get along, you know, because that we learn that, okay, everybody's different. Mm-hmm. You know, we, you know, that way we can take, accept for who they are.
Oh, absolutely.
You know, not
yeah.
change them, or, you know, because you're different or you believe in something different or you look different.
Right.
You know, that we hate each other, learn to get along and just, you
Isn't
know.
Isn't that crazy?
Yeah, it is, you know. I mean, even with our even with our own race and our own color, you know, mm-hmm. one shade doesn't like another shade.
Oh, my goodness.
You know,
that
and things
is such
like
a
that.
Real thing.
So I just want to yeah. pass that down to them. That way everybody changes their mindset, the way they feel about each other.
Right. I like that. And where can people find you?
They can find me on my webpage at therenaissanceman.es, or you can email me at cornelius@therenaissanceman.es.com. Or you can reach my telephone, area code 951-238-4720.
And does if people were to reach out to you, do they need to schedule a time to actually speak with you? Is that something that they can?
No, it depends on what I'm doing. But if they reach out to me, then I will schedule a time to talk to them. That way I can be able to take time to talk to them and, you know, give them that personal attention to find out what it is they want. And what it is that I can do for them.
All right, awesome. Well, it's been great having you on the show today. I'm
Thanks
so glad
me.
That we finally got a chance to do this.
Yes.
We'll definitely be able to connect at another time. But thank you guys. And you
Looking
guys,
forward to it.
Yeah,
thank
absolutely.
You.
This is Briana Prince, your host of The Journey to Business and Entrepreneurship, and we'll see you guys next week. Take care.
KCAA and KCAA Internet Television, the station that leaves no listener and no viewer behind.
KCAA invites you to join Dr. Sean Pruitt, the pharmacist on call, each Monday afternoon at 1 p.m. on KCAA. Dr. Pruitt is known as the pharmacist for the uninsured. Dr. Pruitt listens to your medical questions and he takes your concerns seriously. So tune in to Dr. Sean Pruitt each Monday afternoon at 1 p.m. right here on KCAA Radio, 1050 a.m. and 106.5 FM, the station that leaves no listener behind.
Tahi Boutique Club's original Pure Pal D'Argo Super Tea helps build red corpuscles in the blood, which carry oxygen to our organs and cells. Our organs and cells need oxygen to regenerate themselves. The immune system needs oxygen to develop, and cancer dies in oxygen. So the tea is great for healthy people because it helps build the immune system. And it can truly be miraculous for someone fighting a potentially life-threatening disease due to an infection, diabetes, or cancer. The tea is also organic and naturally caffeine-free. A one-pound package of tea is $49.95, which includes shipping. To order, please visit TahiboTeaClub.com. Tahibo is spelled T like Tom, A-H-E-E, B like boy, O, then continue with the word tea, and then the word club. The complete website is TahiboTeaClub.com. Or call us at 818-610-8088, Monday through Saturday, 9 a.m. to 5 p.m. California time. That's 818-610-8088, TahiboTeaClub.com.
Happy 4th of July from this radio station. It's time to celebrate again this year with the Native Sons of the Golden West Arrowhead Parlor and their family-safe fireworks. This year, the Native Sons have moved two blocks south of the 210 freeway to 2500 North Del Rosa Avenue. That's 2500 North Del Rosa Avenue at the corner of Pumalo, next to the Dental Center, and across from Wawa Grill.
Piccolo Pete's, Buzzing Bees, Flaming Flowers, and the all-time favorite Sparkler. Spark on the 4th of July, just like the ones available at the Native Sons of the Golden West Fireworks booth in San Bernardino. The Golden Sons not only celebrate our nation, but our great state of California through friendship, loyalty, and charity. They support our communities through volunteerism. Support them with your fireworks sale. The Native Sons Arrowhead Parlor 110 would like to remind you that only safe-approved fireworks, like the ones sold at their fireworks stand, now through the 4th, are allowed. And no fireworks are to be ignited above the 210 freeway. And remember to keep fireworks out of the hands of children. Keep it safe with the Native Sons of the Golden West in San Bernardino and fireworks from their booth just south of the 210 freeway in San Bernardino.
Be sure you don't miss out. Fireworks stands are limited, and the Native Sons have sold out every year on or before the 4th for the past 4 years at 2500 North Del Rosa Avenue in San Bernardino.
This segment sponsored by the generous support of the Dream Team. Looking for the keys to something bigger and better? Downsizing or relocating to the perfect spot? Oscar Ramirez from Century 21 Lois Lauer Real Estate and Matt Flores from Secure Choice Lending are here to help you sell or buy with their trusted and experienced knowledge and advice. People are calling Oscar and Matt at 951-751-3249. That's 951-751-3249. Real estate and loan advisors Oscar and Matt can give you a no-cost consultation. You don't have to buy anything. Matt and Oscar can help you figure your way through the complicated real estate market. Email Oscar at loislauer.com or on Instagram at Oscar Ramirez Garcia and Matt Flores at securechoicelending.com. Don't let today's real estate pitfalls stop you from dreaming. Make your new home dreams come true. DRE number 0207-0344. Se habla español.
What is your plan for your beneficiaries to manage your final expenses when you pass away? Life insurance, annuities, bank accounts, investment accounts all require a death certificate, which takes 10 days based on the national average, which means no money is immediately available, and this causes stress and arguments. Simple solution, the beneficiary liquidity plan. Use money you already have. No need to come up with additional funds. The funds grow tax-deferred and pass tax-free to your named beneficiaries. The death benefit is paid out in 24 to 48 hours without a death certificate. You heard me right. Without a death certificate. Call us at 1-800-306-5086, 1-800-306-5086, or reach us online at bigwealthpartners.com.
I'm Rick Smith, host of The Rick Smith Show, inviting you to listen to my show during the noon hour every weekday right here on KCAA. My show is sponsored locally by Teamsters 1932, a strong union with 14,000 members in the IE. Our message is clear. Unions improve the lives of working people. You have a right to form and join a union, so go to Teamsters1932.org and get started now.
Do you want to learn and get answers to questions not addressed in the mass media? Then you want to hear my show, Business Game Changers, with me, Sarah Westall. I have conversations with thought leaders who have the courage to address off-limit topics so you and your family have the tools to make the right decisions. Join me Wednesdays at 4 p.m. on 1050 a.m. and 106.5 FM right here at KCAA, that station that leaves no listener behind.
NBC News Radio, I'm Tammy Trujillo. Police in Baltimore, Maryland are providing an update at this hour on a mass shooting overnight. Two people were killed and 28 others wounded when gunfire erupted at a crowded block party just after midnight. Some witnesses say so many rounds were fired they initially thought they were hearing holiday fireworks. Police are working to identify possible suspects. Baltimore Mayor Brandon Scott has vowed to bring those responsible to justice.
Someone out there knows. And we want everybody who was out there, somebody knows who did this. I don't care if it's the parents, the brother, the wife, the girlfriend of those who are responsible. We need you to say something.
He called the shooting a cowardly act. Former Vice President Mike Pence says President Biden is acting too slowly in providing military weapons to Ukraine. Speaking on CBS's Face the Nation, Pence said the Biden administration has not delivered on weapons it promised months ago. Pence just returned from Ukraine, where he met with President Volodymyr Zelensky. Pence praised Zelensky, the Ukrainian people, and the Ukrainian military, saying they're the reason Russia has gone from being the second most powerful military in the world to being the second most powerful military in Ukraine. France is being rocked by a fifth day of protests over the police shooting of a teenager. Thousands of riot police are patrolling the streets of Paris and other major cities the day after the funeral of Nahel Mazurk. The 17-year-old boy was shot in the chest by police last week at a checkpoint in a Paris suburb. United Airlines is giving 30,000 frequent flyer miles to travelers delayed by the massive flight disruptions over the past week. Bad weather launched United's issues, which included takeoffs delayed by as much as 75% for longer than 8 hours last week. United CEO Scott Kirby said the airline will have to cut or change schedules unless it can get more gates at its Newark Liberty International Airport hub. You're listening to The Latest. I'm Tammy Trujillo.
You're on board KCAA's